Shall we start, sir?
Hello?
Yeah, shall we start, sir?
Yeah, you can start. Have you got everybody on board?
I think so. Yeah, everybody is. Yeah.
All right. And how many audience we have? Like, what sort of people are listening to it now?
So, audience will be all on Ortho TV. So, you will not be able to see them. All interactions right. Is all amongst the faculty.
Great. So, I would want to, first of all, welcome everybody. Can we do a screen sharing?
Yes, sir.
Brilliant.
So,
hi, I'm Dr. Jaggi. And I've been reading about all of you and all. It all seems very, very impressive. So, I'm in the middle of very distinguished people around here. So, I'll not be taking a lot of time. I think I'll just be introducing all of you. And I would let, you know, it's a one-hour thing. With 10 minutes for each of the speakers, that's good enough. I'll just make a very, very brief introduction about orthobiologics, which we all, I think, are doing a lot. I've been practicing it for the last almost 10 years, almost for 4 years in UK, and for the last 5 to 6 years that I've come back in India. So I think we are in the third generation now. We started with the first generation with hyaluronic acid, came up to BRP as a second generation. Now with the BMAC and BMPs into the third generation now. So the first speaker is Dr. Mukhopadhyay. He's going to speak about the current concepts of articular cartilage restoration techniques and treatment algorithms. So I'll let Dr. Mukhopadhyay start. He's, again, we have a very good, I think, 3 hours from NCR, then Surat, Bombay, and Chennai. That's a brilliant thing. So Dr. Mukhopadhyay is predominantly interested in sports injuries and is an arthroscopic surgeon. And he has done some very good work and has been trained extensively in India as well as abroad, right from Germany, Hong Kong, and United Kingdom. So I would advise, welcome him for the first talk and let him start and we can take it from there then.
Okay, so before Dr. Mukhopadhyay starts, I'll take this opportunity to introduce our course chairman, Dr. Jatinder Bir Singh Jaggi. He is the associate director at Max Hospital, Gurgaon, and has specialty interest in lower limb replacement surgery, hip and knee primary and revision surgery, minimally invasive joint replacement, complex trauma, and joint preservation, especially sports injury and arthroscopic ligament reconstruction. Foot and ankle surgery, including hallux deformity, forefoot deformities, and other arthritic and traumatic foot and ankle problems. He had represented University of Dundee at the Queen's reception in Palace of Holyrood House, Edinburgh. So I welcome our course chairman, and let's begin with our program with Dr. Mukhopadhyay. Over to you, Dr. Mukhopadhyay.
Thank you, Dr. Jaggi, and thank you, Dr. Shyam.
Just click on the slide and you can go to the first one.
So, for the topic, firstly, I thank all of you, the organizers, and Dr. Jaggi and Dr. Ashok Chan for giving me this opportunity. So my topic was to talk about the current concepts of articular cartilage restoration techniques and treatment algorithms, which I believe has been discussed a lot over the decade, has been debated at a lot of conferences, a lot of consensus meetings, and a lot of literature is there on what is the ideal cartilage restoration technique. So to begin with, this is a patient, late 30s, a colleague and a medical colleague complaining of pain in the knee for over 5 years now. Both knees are painful, but the right is slightly more painful than the left. Relatively a sedentary lifestyle, not into active sports besides slight amount of morning walks and jogging. The pain has progressively increased over the last 5 years. These are the most recent x-rays. Pain is typically more when getting up from a sitting position. Has tried all kind of conservative treatments from quadriceps strengthening, core strengthening, hip strengthening exercises to having taken analgesics, having taken chondro supplement medications, but the pain is still persisting. Considering her medical background and a very adamant history of persistent nagging pain in the joint for over last 5 years, with a stable joint, stable ligaments, no tibiofemoral joint line tenderness, although retropodal tenderness was there, which was leading us to the diagnosis, we got an MRI done, which classically showed a lesion in the patella. Seeing this MRI, the first response was to give her again a trial of conservative, maybe try some intra-articular injections. But the patient was very adamant that, doctor, I have been trying for 5 years. I have tried everything. I have taken intra-articular injections as well, but the pain doesn't go. So please give me something which will solve my problem. That is when I thought of trying something to help her get relief of the pain that she is having. These are small lesions. On the MRI, I think the report said hardly something around 5 or 6 millimeters by 7-8 millimeters. So very small lesions. We went in, saw the lesion on arthroscope. Again, a grade 3 kind of lesion, which could have very well been just debrided chondroplasty or maybe some microfracture. And we could have just left it at that. Classical algorithms, classical teachings would have said a simple microfracture, chondroplasty would have been all that is required. But having in mind the history of the patient and wanting a foolproof treatment, I decided to do a BMAC for this patient. It's a simple procedure. You aspirate the bone marrow, you process it in a specialized machine chamber where the bone marrow gets concentrated. And so we opened up, the lesions were about 7 to 6 millimeters and 8 into 7 millimeters after debridement. And using Tisil fibrin glue, we covered the both the lesions with bone marrow aspirate and make sure that we had a nice coverage of the entire two lesions. And the rest of the joint was absolutely normal with no ligamental instability or meniscus lesions or any other cartilage lesion. So that brings us to the topic of the algorithms. Although there are many papers, many literature, a lot of literature is available, discussed over many conferences, but do we have to stick to the guidelines that have been laid down? Classically, as I said, this was a typical lesion which could have been managed with a chondroplasty or at max some amount of microfracture. But why did I choose a BMAC and not abide by the classical teachings of going by the size of the lesion, the intensity of activity, the kind of activity that the patient does, and whether it is associated with any ligamentous laxity or not? Coming to it, so now BMAC is basically nothing but a concentration of stem cells. Stem cells, when concentrated, can be stimulated to regenerate into any kind of tissue that it gets an adequate environment for. The typical healing triad of having the growth factors, having its scaffold, and the stem cells itself would stimulate generation of the tissue that you want it to grow into. Now, a concentrated bone marrow aspirate, in addition with the concentration of bone marrow, has a lot of growth factors, has the serotonin and the ADPs, has accelerated tissue repair processes going on, which promote the mesenchymal stem cells to differentiate into the specific tissue that we want it to regenerate into, provided the environment is apt. The sources of mesenchymal stem cells are many, but the bone marrow aspirate is a easy way of aspirating and recruiting stem cells. There are other ways are of abdominal fats have been used recently to again concentrate stem cells and later potentiate into differentiation into cartilage cells and all. So these mesenchymal stem cells have the potential to differentiate into multiple cell lines. They have anti-inflammatory properties. They can self-induce pro-angiogenesis and immunomodulation, which in totality help in regeneration of a stable tissue structure. So, as we all know, the bone marrow is aspirated and concentrated. I would not detail into this slide. This is something which happens when we centrifuge the aspirate at a very high speed. And the concentrate, as we see this slide, we can see that the bone marrow aspirate, when compared to the concentrate has several times higher amount of mesenchymal stem cells than the primary aspirate in itself. I also did a little bit more research on the various kinds of bone marrow aspirate or concentrates that are available in the market. And somehow this particular brand showed to have a relatively higher and a better proliferating bone marrow aspirate concentrate than the other brands. Definitely this needs to be further evaluated and studied. But this is a simple procedure. This particular brand, you can use any of the sites for bone marrow aspirate, be it your iliac crest, the tibial condyle. You aspirate it, you concentrate it, and you have your bone marrow aspirate ready. So how does this biological augmentation actually happen? It can help regenerate the cartilage by covering the entire full thickness cartilage lesion into a relatively more hyaline-like stable cartilage, which compared to a simple chondroplasty or microfracture would have produced a relatively weaker kind of a fibrocartilaginous structure, which may not be providing the properties of a good hyaline cartilage that normally lines our joints. So bone marrow aspirate would produce a relatively more hyaline-like structure compared to a simple chondroplasty or a microfracture. Adding the fibrin glue helps in decreasing the setting times and stabilizes the clot faster. Even if you don't use the fibrin glue, the aspirate does settle down over a longer, which could be around 30 minutes with the fibrin glue, about 2 to 3 minutes, and we have a stable structure ready. There have also been studies of using this bone marrow aspirate in osteoarthritis grade 2 to grade 4, but however, my personal experience would say grade 1 and 2, it has relatively good outcomes. Grade 3 and 4, I would personally not use bone marrow aspirate or even lipoaspirate as I was talking about in osteoarthritis patients. So, sorry for deviating little from the topic that I had on discussing the algorithms and the principles of cartilage repair, but I thought that since we have all been using and doing cartilage repair, we know about the concepts. Let's discuss something which is not usually talked about in such small lesions, something which would be probably criticized by a lot of faculty members, why I did BMAC in such a small lesion, which could have been probably even left alone, leave aside chondroplasty or microfracture. But I think BMAC or bone marrow aspirate or any form of mesenchymal stem cell procedure is worth considering in patients who have been suffering for so long, which can lead to generation of good quality, stable, hyaline-like cartilage, relieving these patients of their problems. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mukhopadhyay. That was a brilliant talk. And I think I agree with you there when you said, listening to the patient, that makes a lot of difference. Yeah. Of what we are trying to achieve, the back history, what the patient expectations are. And to be very frank, I'll just a small thing from my own experiences. See, this is still an evolving field.
Yes.
We are still not as a system as such of orthobiologics, because there is a lot of variation, extremely on the competence of people doing it, the systems available. So we have still not used a level of standardization.
Yes.
So
yes,
we definitely have to change and accept things as they come. And that is how we're going to progress further. But going on to the next topic, which sounds very interesting, that's by Dr. Krunal Shah from Surat, from Gujarat. He's a surgeon from there and has traveled again a lot in the world. He's been trained in Germany. He's been trained with Dr. Mr. Stephen. Steve was my boss at one time. Me and Steve worked for a pretty long time together, actually. So it was good to see that you were there. And he's going to talk about outcomes of chondral autograft transplantation versus fracture in treatment of these in the knee joint. Over to Dr. Kunal Shah. Dr. Shah?
You can just click the play button up there.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes.
I'm sorry for that interruption. Thank you, Dr. Jaggi. Thank you, Dr. Shyam, and all the organizers for giving this opportunity to share my experience on this topic, which is osteochondral autologous transfer system versus microfracture, specifically in the knee joint chondral injuries. So just to make sure that we are talking about this type of very circumscribed, very defined chondral lesions and not actually degenerative arthritic chondral injuries when we are talking about OATS or microfractures. I'm sharing two clinical case scenarios to prove my point. The first is a 30 years old male. He has no history of fall or trauma and he has complained of pain and swelling and locking since last 20 days, and basically he is a brother of a doctor, so has a medical background that way. If I elaborate more elaborate more his profile, he is a farm related product seller. So what I mean to say is he has to go into farm by farm in the villages, walk on an uneven surface and sell his products related to farming. I would come to the point why this point is really important. He's the only earning member of his family. So being a brother to a doctor, he was already been worked up. This is the x-ray which he came with. And what I can appreciate is there was some chondral lesion on his lateral femoral condyle, which was weight bearing area. And when I saw the MRI, it was suggestive of a big chondral defect. So the question came to my mind, and which always confuses me in this type of clinical profile and this type of cases, are whether to go for an autologous chondrocyte implantation or OATS or a microfracture. Now, honestly speaking, I was more in favor of ACI because he was a young chap, very active, and if we go with the literature, it suggests that ACI ends up with more of a type 2 collagen than type 1. And OATS is though type 2, but interfered with some of the type 1 collagen. Microfractures, as well described and well studied by Dr. Brian Cole, at the end of 2 years, probably ends up with the same type of fibrocartilage and not exactly the hyaline cartilage. And it has more of a type 1 collagen in the hyaline cartilage. And but this patient particularly opted for the second option, that is OATS. And I tell you, many of my patients, they go for the second option because first, it is cheaper. And I have to be practical when I'm discussing this, that it is third time the cost of what the ACI cost, because I sometimes reuse the OATS kits and sometimes 2 to 3 times I reuse it and sterilize it with the sterilize it. So it is third time the cost. Second, it is a single stage procedure in a clinic, in a clinical profile which I describe that he's a single earning member. To keep him non-earning for 3 months probably makes lots of difference. So when we discuss this type of points with the patients, many of them, even against our scientific and literature advice, they go for OATS. And if I follow my cases, I have done this type of 8 cases, which have been followed for more than 3 years. Some other are of short-term duration, but they all are doing absolutely fantastically well. So sometimes we need to reevaluate and rethink our decision. If I consider OATS, then the confusion is whether to go for arthroscopic or open. I am more in favor of open. I start doing it arthroscopic, but honestly speaking, in my limited experienced eyes, I do not get that trajectory very perpendicular to the chondral surface. So I have moved to a mini open procedure than actually doing it arthroscopic. So this was the case. He had around 3 into 4 centimeter chondral lesion on the femoral condyle. And this is how it was. And we can appreciate, which is a very important point, is that we can appreciate some of the calcified cartilage on the subchondral bone, which has to be removed, whatever procedure we opt for, whether it is ACI, whether it is OATS, or whether it is microfracture. But this type of calcified cartilage on the subchondral bone has to be very meticulously removed, whatever procedure we do. So I opted for OATS, and I packed it with 4 cylinders, taking it from a non-weight bearing area of the trochlea. And this was the pre-operative. The other point in favor of ACI, some of the times even we can take this cartilage piece also to culture the cartilage for ACI, for the growth of the ACI. And we started range of motion at third day. He was kept non-weight bearing for three weeks. He started non-weight bearing from third day and was kept toe-touch weight bearing for 3 weeks. Gradual partial to full weight bearing was allowed at 6 weeks, and running was permitted after 3 months. This was post-op MRI at 9 months. What we can appreciate is more or less those cylinders have been taken up, and it is well aligned with the native cartilage. This is what you see is integration of the osteochondral plug into the lateral femoral condyle with no evidence of any hyper-intense gap line between the tissue. So it indicates that the cartilage is well taken up. And clinically, patient was absolutely well. In fact, all these patients, I always want to do a redo scopy, and I sometimes offer them to do it free of cost and on their convenience and everything, but they don't have any complaints. So they do not turn up to do a second procedure. I try to convince them to just have my literature presentation even better. But these patients, they do not turn up to do this type of procedure. That itself shows that sometimes the OATS gives as good results as ACI, though literature in 4 into 3 centimeter defect is more in favor of ACI than OATS. This is the other case of similar background, but this was around 8 years back. So what I did was microfracture. At that time, I was not very much following OATS or ACI. So this is how I do my microfractures. I always use a chondropic, and I go. I'd never do drilling, which is nowadays much preferred or much recommended. I always use chondropic. And I keep it 5 millimeter away, and usually you go 5 to 6 millimeter inside. As I said previously, very important to remove the overlying calcified cartilage over the subchondral bone. In my personal opinions, in isolated osteochondral defects, my results are not as good as OATS or ACI. Patients, they keep on complaining and coming to the OPD if I do perform this type of microfractures in particularly this type of defect. Though if it is an isolated small defect in ACL associated with ACL reconstruction or a meniscal repair, very small defect, then they do well, as shown very well by Dr. Mukhopadhyay in his algorithm, that smaller defects, they do well with microfractures, or even they may do well if you just remove the cause, that is ACL instability. But in larger defects, probably in my views or in my experience, or at least in my hands, microfracture is not a very good procedure. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shah. Very good presentation. I think the message you are sending is good. And I agree with you that doing transfer and doing it open sometimes or most of the times is better. Your cylinders are much better taken when you open it up, and placing them is again way better open than arthroscopy. It's a different thing presenting it and doing it on table. So, but really well done cases. I think we should now move south, and I would invite Dr. Madan from Chennai. He has worked abroad. He's worked in UK as well for around more than 10 years. He's come back and is doing wonderful job in South India. He's going to talk about the next generation single stage treatment options for chondral and osteochondral defects. It's a very interesting topic, and over to you, Dr. Madan.
Okay, go ahead. We can see
just
and hear
you. Can you see my video?
Yeah, we can see. Not your video, but your presentation. We can see.
Oh, fine. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Thanks, Dr. Jaggi, for introducing me. And thanks for giving me the opportunity for presenting this unique procedure. As Dr. Jaggi was saying, we have moved into different generations. First generation, second generation, third generation. So we have been evolving into new innovation and technology in cartilage replacement and how the cartilage has to be managed, how to preserve it before subjecting to total knee replacement. So this is what it's all about now. Yeah, it's somehow it stopped my thing. So just let me check on that one.
Just click on the slide and then it will move by.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to do. Okay, fine. It's going. So yeah, well, what we need to know is what is cartilage? I just thought I'll do some basics on the purpose of the PG, so anybody who has joined it. So quickly rush to us. So as you know, that articular cartilage is about hyaline cartilage, mainly hyaline cartilage. It's composed of water and it's mostly type 2 collagen, and you got proteoglycan and chondrocytes of the cells, and then you got the matrix which forms as a glue to support this. Now, why we need to repair the cartilage? So why doesn't it heal by itself? So this is a question to be asked. So as we all know that cartilage is mostly avascular and it's aneural as well. So that is why when the cartilage is still present there, you don't get joint pains. Only when the cartilage is gone, you get this subchondral bone exposed, and then you get this nerve endings and you get the pain in the joint. The other thing is it's alympathic, and mostly cartilage gets its nutrition by mechanical stimulus. So it's by the diffusion from the synovial fluid, which gets the nutrition and oxygen as well. So that is why all my patients, I say mobility is very important. I don't restrict them on mobility. So that is one of my prime treatment plan. As we all know from olden days, the cartilage has been never been replaced with the same cartilage. It's mostly a hyaline cartilage, which it's replaced by fibrocartilage, if that's the case. And in 17th century itself, William Hunter has rightly quoted ulcerate cartilage is a troublesome thing. Once destroyed, it is never been repaired. So that is the one thing which we need to know. And same thing, James Paget as well quoted in 1853 in his paper. Now, coming to the treatment options, as my previous colleague has discussed on the algorithms on various treatments options as well, and we talked about OATS and microstructures as one of the treatment options. And coming to treatment options, widely divided into conservative. Conservative, you got analgesics, injections, and braces as well. I'm keen on talking about the surgical options today. So surgical options, debridement was familiarized by Magnusson in 1941. And then came into the second generation where you got a abrasion chondroplasty and microfractures, which was familiarized by Stedman in 1990. And then we got mosaicplasty and Oates procedure. And now the technology is MACI. MACI was by Brahams in 2005, which was introduced arthroscopically as well as open procedure. Now, what is new? This is where we need to say what is new now. So it's all been described various modes of treatment. So new is what you call the AutoCAD. So AutoCAD is the one which technology which Arthrex has come up newly with. I have used AutoCAD just on a few patients for now. I'll present it in my later talk. One was in December when they first introduced in India. I was the first surgeon to do this procedure. And she has been doing very great as well. Still now, I've done few procedures that all are doing fine. The patient selection is very important while you do this procedure. It's a what I also call this as a one-step autologous minced cartilage procedure. So this was previously described. Now they changed the name into different names. Now it's called by the company, it's called as AutoCAD now. So it's a quick recovery and mobilization, shorter rehabilitation, and cost effective too, because it's a single step procedure. Let me go into some of the details on that. As I said, it's a single stage procedure. Arthroscopically, I harvest the cartilage. For that, you need a special shaver, what we call a shaver, which minces the cartilage and makes into very micro fragments. And then, of course, we need that PRP. So PRP, we can use two different PRPs. One is plasma-rich PRP or plasma-poor PRP. I use a plasma-rich PRP in this case, and we need a special thing called what is called a thrombinator. I'll show this in my next slide. So thrombinator, what it does is we put a PRP, it changes due to clotting factors, the thrombin is formed. So this forms as a small glue to put the cartilage back in the site where it has been damaged. And next is, of course, we all know we have to debride the area which has been damaged as well. I do all this in arthroscopically as well. So I know a few surgeons told that we can do, I mean, it's open technique as well. So what I use is to dry the cartilage, I use an air insufflation, either carbon dioxide or nitrogen. So this is what I use to dry the cartilage. And then I use anti-gravity and then fill up the cartilage defect as well. So all my procedures so far has been arthroscopic for now. So this is what in the nutshell it's all about. So let me go into the detail of this procedure. So this is what I was mentioning. If you see here, this is a special shaver, which is called as a shaver, which comes at 3 millimeter and 4 millimeter. It's got a special tooth in it. So where it can shave the cartilage on that. So I harvest the cartilage from the non-weight bearing area, like you do in a MACI procedure for sending it. MACI procedure is a two stages procedure where you take the cartilage, it has to be grown, and then you wait for another 6 to 8 weeks to put it back on. So this is where I thought I will try this one, and it worked excellent to me. This shaver, I mentioned, there's another thing called what's the graft net. Graft net is the one we have to catch the whatever the cartilage we have been shaving. It has to be caught in some sort of form. So what I do is what they have come up with is with the suction tubing. So before that, it sucks. So you can connect this to the suction portal in the arthroscopic one. So if you carefully look into the graft net, what it has got is a special filter inside. So whatever it sucks out, it filters it, and then it sucks the water out. So what you can get from the filter is a fine minced cartilage. So this is, of course, on the left side, if you see on the screen, it's an applicator troca, so where we need to apply it. It's all arthroscopically done, so I use this one. And of course, this is a thrombinator. Thrombinator is the one when we get the PRP. So we use about 12 mils of the PRP and then shake it, put this inside this thrombinator and shake it down. The thrombinator contains the calcium chloride in it that triggers the clotting factors. But since you are putting the platelet-rich plasma, it's not a blood clot is formed. So it's a fibrin clot we are looking for. So this is a PRP machine, which it's been used. So I think a previous speaker told about him about this as well, PRP, and then subsequently there'll be more talks on it. So I just don't want to go in detail into that. So let me present my case and how I did this one. So this is Mrs. Sarah, which was a 69 years old female. She was from US. So she had few surgeries in the US. Arthroscopic procedure, and she had done for the both the knees, and she had a patella mal tracking as well. So for that, she had bony procedures as well. She was not quite pleased with that because she was still in pain. So that's the reason she came to me. And she's a keen traveler and she likes dancing, especially Bollywood dancing, and a swimmer as well. So she's a sports person, even though the age is 69, but she's quite a sporty person. Pain was too dull, and then it progressed to the sharp pain, which is mostly on the medial side. Both the knee was painful, but she was more concerned on the left knee when she came to me. Day-to-day activity was slightly restricted due to the pain, and then as I told, it was mostly a medial side joint tenderness, and there was no instability in the knee. So X-ray showed some grade 3 OA changes, and this is the X-ray. As you see in the right, you can see the osteophytes on that, but the left side, you can't see much of the arthritis changes in the knee. So I always do an MR scan for these people. So I take a plain MRI and I also do a cartilage mapping before I do any cartilage procedures. So that gives me an idea of how much of cartilage is deficient and what type of surgery I can offer to them. So we got this cartilage mapping in our hospital where I work. So this is a plain MRI. As you can see in the MRI itself, you can see a small defect down there and some periphery osteophytes. But the main pain was mostly on here. So it doesn't have much pain on that as well. So meniscus was all intact. There was not any degenerative changes as such. And if you see the cartilage mapping here, so you can see the exactly measure the thickness of the cartilage, how much of damage is there and where is the defect going on and which area I should address on that. So this gives me a clue or planning before surgery. So this is what arthroscopically when I went in, so you can see this defect down there. So in this case, what I did was I tried to get a cartilage from surrounding area on that using the shaver. And debrided it. As I debrided it, I collected the cartilage using the shaver. So this is a short video on how it is done. We play this. This is the graft net. You can see how tiny the fragments are, cartilage fragments have been minced. So that is why I call this as a one-step minced cartilage replacement. And this is the plasma.
Yes, sir.
Platelet-rich plasma, which we got it before. We need exactly about 60 ml of blood to get about at least 15 ml of PRP. So I use 12 ml for the thrombinator. And get 1 ml of the PRP to be mixed with the minced cartilage so that you need some medium to insert it back on. I use 1 ml of the PRP, which I've taken it before. Mix it with the cartilage, and there's a special syringe for this. Half an hour, sir. So all this harvesting, the cartilage, this is what it is. So we got a PRP, which is separating. Got a double cannula here. So PRP is separated by using the ACP thing. And this is all using the, as I showed in the previous slides, special trocar and syringes. So I dry the cartilage, air insufflation, I do it. So you can see the, how dry it is. And then use a small gauze as well, arthroscopically, and dry them as well the side. And then this is how the cartilage is being put in. And I use the back of the needle to flatten it. So what we need to do is we shouldn't be filling up the whole defect with the cartilage, minced cartilage. So what I do is 80% of the thing, I fill it up. And then I use that thrombinator, which I told you, the PRP, which is converted into the fibrin clot. So this is I seal it with a fibrin clot. So there is special syringes which has come up, which is a dual syringes where you can inject a thrombinator as well as the PRP. And when it hits the site, it forms the fibrin clot. So instead of doing it two syringes, getting one by one, putting the cartilage and then thrombinator and then putting the PRP, there is a special syringe which has got two cannulas. So when you drive in, so both can be simultaneously sealing the defect as well. So this is a short video, 6 weeks follow-up.
Please come on.
I put on a brace. It's a medial offloading brace initially. Why? Because
take your time.
When she came in, she has already booked a holiday to go to Sri Lanka as well. So she gave me only a 4 weeks interval. So I had to put on a knee brace so she can mobilize. You can see the picture there. She can go on the stairs as well using the knee brace. This is without the knee brace. This is 2 weeks after she can walk without the knee brace as well. This is not a rehabilitation. And in fact, she came back after the Sri Lanka to show me this video, how she has been doing wonderful on that. And also she told me she went to Jaipur as well and did some few climbing stairs and all. She has been excellent after this procedure. This is a short video which she sent me from States now. So where she's doing the Taekwondo practice. This I received just 2 days ago. I just thought I will show you. I'll quickly run through. It's a big video, but I'll quickly run through it.
Hi, Dr. Madan. I'd like to show you a little bit about the kickboxing that I do. I can't squat down low.
As I told you, she's a keen sports person, so she does kickboxing as well.
And so there's and a keeps lead her very punch. Fit. So it would be like cross, jab, cross, hook, hook, block, and then you'll come into doing.
You can see the knee,
kicks.
The left knee is the one that
and
she
again,
has.
And again, I modified
how,
all the kicks.
Efficiently,
a kick
she can
like this.
She can even do a single stand on the left knee.
A front kick. I
you
don't.
Can see the balancing on the
they,
left
when
knee.
When they kick, they kick.
That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Madan. That was quite interesting. I personally have not done any autocarts, but I've heard about it and seen it, but not done any of them personally as such, but sounds interesting. And I think you have rekindled the interest even further. I would now like to invite Dr. Manu Bora, who's from NCR region. You're back up north now. He's an arthroscopic surgeon and does all sorts of joints. And he's going to talk on a very interesting topic, which is an evolving topic, I would say, on autologous conditioned plasma for osteoarthritis. And how is it better than steroids as a treatment option? Again, I think that's a very pertinent question because when you're trying to tell somebody to get a plasma done instead of a steroid, the first question which I think Dr. Manu would, I would want him to answer is, you know, the cost factor which comes into the fact, the cost and the guarantee of it working. So I think that question he's going to answer that how is it better than steroids? So over to Dr. Manu Bora.
Thank you so much, sir. I am going to share my screen. And so there's this autologous conditioned plasma. So what is the difference between a PRP and ACP? So ACP is basically an arthritis product. So conventionally, if I send a patient to a blood bank for a PRP, it takes an hour or so to prepare a PRP, whereas ACP can be prepared within minutes. So ACP is a double syringe system, which makes it easy. and the whole preparation is very in a closed system. So there is less chance of infection, which we are always worried about the infection. If we are doing some OPD procedure, just injecting the knee and the patient comes with the infection, that's a disaster. So this system is minimizing the infection as well. As you can see, the ACP is a centrifuge machine, name is Angel by Arthrex, and it is a double syringe module in which the PRP comes in an inner syringe after the spinning, and it takes about 8 to 10 minutes of spinning and you get the PRP around 6 ml. So what is the mechanism of ACP or PRP? So when platelets are comes in contact with the damaged injured tissue, whether a damaged cartilage or damaged tendon or an injured ligament, then they get activated. So 70% of the growth factors contained within the alpha granules are secreted within the first 10 minutes. What they do, they induce the proliferation and differentiation of various cells like stem cells, osteoblasts, epidermal cells. They also enhance the production of collagen, proteoglycans, stimulate angiogenesis, chemokines. So these all things we already know and it is all theoretical. So what I did, that we started studying that does the PRP really work or it doesn't. So we did a studies about 40 candidates, male and female, both age group of 20 to 40 years with chondromalacia patelli we took. So our PRP or ACP regime protocol was, we gave 3 sessions of double dose ACP from day 0, day 7 and day 40. So concentration of platelets in this is around 2.5 times the blood that we checked in the blood bank. We took the VAS, IKDC and Tegner lysome scores on the day 0, that is before the procedure, 1 week, 3 weeks, 6 weeks, 3 months and 1 year. There is a specific role of exercises and what to do after the injection, whether to give 1 injection, 2 injection, 3 injection, this is also a question. So we always stick to a protocol that we need to give 3 injections, 3 sessions. So no hot and cold fomentation after the injection, whether it's in the shoulder or knee. No anti-inflammatory medication should be given at least for 2 to 3 days. If the patient is having a pain after that, he can take paracetamol, but no NSAID. Strictly, they have to tell to avoid smoking. Drinking, they can avoid for 2-3 days post-injection. Exercises plays a very pivotal role, but we restrict exercises 2 days, no exercises, and then he can start exercises. Specifically for the chondromalacia, I like to use this specific knee sleeve, which has a silicone patellar ring, which uplifts the patella and acts as a it supports the VMO. So we used to give this sleeve. There's a company named as Medi. You can get a Genu Medi, which is a very good brand. So after 2 days, they need to wear these sleeves only while exercising. What kind of exercises? We always start with a VMO strengthening. I am again telling you, only VMO strengthening. Don't start with the quadriceps extension or hamstring exercises, because most of the patients with chondromalacia have weak VMO. So focus on VMO first and then progress to other exercises. So first week is simple VMO exercises like sitting football press. They can do back bridge with TheraBand or back bridge with football. They can start the climb exercises. So these are the simple protocol for 1 week. Second week, we increase the exercises, but again, only VMO exercises. So the sumo squats or the squats with TheraBand and squats for football came along. After this week, when the patient is pain-free, a bit of symptom-free, then we can add other more advanced exercises like eccentric quadricep exercises, because I treat many athletes from kabaddi and pro kabaddi and wrestlers. So the focus on eccentric exercises are pivotal in my practice. So once the patient is pain-free, we always encourage them to do eccentric quadriceps, eccentric hamstring and advanced vastus medialis obliquus exercises like one-legged single squats, and there are many other, and balance training. And then we took out the results. So pre-procedure, the lysome score was 65.9. After 1 week, means after the first injection, there is always a deterioration in the pain scores and the scores, because the PRP do a lot of inflammation in the knee joint and it generally increases the pain in the first week. But the results start coming very good from the second week, So 80.6 weeks is 87 and 6 months is 89. So as their muscle strength, specific muscle strength keep on increasing, then the results is also getting better and better. Same with the IKDS score, with the pre-processor was 50.6, then it deteriorated in the first week, 53.7, which you have to explain it to the patient that the pain is going to increase, the disability is going to increase within the first week, but they should not take any anti-inflammatory, don't do any hot and ice packs, and just bear the pain. From the second week, they will start getting the results, and 6 week is 6 months is fantastic, 82.6. The same goes with the supraspinatus partial tear and tendinosis ACP. So we again studied 32 candidates in the age group of 20 to 40 years. The exercises is specifically focused and time specific exercise depending upon if they have restricted internal rotation as well with the tendinitis. So we have to start the slipper stretch and other internal rotators stretching exercises, rotator cuff strengthening. Then once everything is fine, they are doing very well, then we progress to the eccentric rotator cuff exercises. Scapular and neck exercises are very important for the shoulder mobility. Upper trapezius stretching and lower and middle trapezius strengthening. So these are the some of the few important points which I always make sure, and we make the exercise schedule according to the specific condition, whether the shoulder is restricted or is partial tear or just the tendinitis. Again, the results is pre-processor is 31.5 in the Oxford score. The first week is a deterioration always. In the frozen shoulder, we specifically, I have excluded the patient from the studies because the frozen shoulder pain drastically increases. So in my opinion, one should not do a PRP in a frozen shoulder. First, they do a stretching schedule. Once the frozen shoulder is element is out, then they can do PRP for a supraspinatus or any rotator cuff tendinitis or partial tear. But if you do a PRP first with the frozen shoulder and initiate the stretching exercises, the patient is never going to come back to you again for because of tremendous pain. But the 6 months, the result are still like the result is still maintained at 45. Same with the UCLA scale, pre-processor 16.8 and after 6 months it is 33. So with the steroid, the results are temporary. The results can deteriorate over months, but with the PRP, once we regenerate, with the ACP, we regenerate, it stays for a longer duration, and we are still in touch with the patient, and we will hopefully make a study when the 1 year or 3 year are completed. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Manu. That was an interesting talk. Now again, traveling back south, I would say in the middle, back to Maharashtra, where I come from actually. We have a dynamic orthopedic surgeon from Mumbai, Dr. Mithin Seth, and he's going to talk about raise the curtains and tell us the difference between autologous conditioned plasma versus platelet-rich plasma, and he's going to talk about what is the difference between ACP and PRP.
Over to you, Dr. Seth. You to stop sharing your screen, please, so that I can start sharing mine. Thank you, Dr. Jaggi, for the introduction. It's a privilege to be on Ortho TV always. I hope you can hear me. And can you see my screen, please?
Yeah, we can hear and see you.
Excellent. So my talk is on the ACP versus PRP. What is the difference? So essentially, the healing...
Just a minute, Mithan. Your screen is lost now once you went full screen. What I'll suggest is stop sharing and reshare again. Go ahead.
Right, I'll do that. So I'm sharing my screen again. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, go ahead.
Super, thank you. So the healing triad involves growth factors, the matrix, and regenerative cells. So growth factors are bioactive signaling molecules. Regenerative cells are mesenchymal stem cells that can differentiate. So that's either from the adipose tissue or from the bone marrow. And then a matrix is needed, a substrate for cell growth. So essentially, these growth factors are used to reduce inflammation and support healing. The regenerative cells are just a second. Yeah, are used for compromised self-healing capacity. And the matrix is used for smaller lesions or defects. Will you excuse me just for a second? Right, thanks. I was just distracted for a bit. Now, so the ACP and the PRP are biological signaling molecules. They are growth factors. BMAC is a combination of both growth factors and regenerative cells. The fibrin crot is a bit of all three, growth factors, regenerative cells, and the matrix. And I'm sorry, the fibrin clot actually won't have these mesenchymal stem cells. Whereas something like an ACI procedure, like an autologous chondrocyte implantation, we will use a bit of everything. So there will be growth factors, there'll be the mesenchymal stem cells, and of course, there'll be a scaffold or a matrix. So platelet-rich plasma is defined as any volume of autologous plasma containing a higher platelet count than peripheral blood. So anything more than 1.5 to 3.5 lakh platelets per ml is platelet-rich. And what is ACP then? The autologous conditioned plasma is just a way of preparing the PRP. So there are many ways of preparing a PRP. ACP is one of them. 15 ml of blood is drawn into a double syringe system from a single spin. So sometimes you can get a PRP that's very rich in platelets. If you can use the blood in the centrifuge, not one, but two times, rarely three times. But the ACP is prepared with a single spin in the centrifuge at a fixed 1500 RPM for 5 minutes. Now, the ACP proceed, once this is done, you get that entire double syringe kit out of the system, and the ACP is procured by pulling back on the secondary syringe to remove the yellow leukocyte poor PRP layer, and what remains behind is the leukocyte rich red blood cell pack behind. So you get somewhere between 4 and 7 mm always. So that's concentrated red blood cells below, a buffy coat sort of in the middle, and platelet-rich plasma at the top. It's a single spin for 5 minutes, no anticoagulant use, one single closed system. So the total prep time is much shorter. It's less than 20 minutes. So there are many ways in which you can classify a platelet-rich plasma. One of the conceptual ways of classifying them is mentioned towards the bottom. That's like the DEPA system. So you need to know what's the dose of platelets injected. So a lot of 5 billion platelets injected goes into an A category. Somewhere between 3 and 5 billion goes into B category. And then the capture efficiency. So if you have a platelet capture system where more than 90% of what you're getting is platelets, so that's a very efficient system. So that's DE, and then the purity of PRP. So what's the ratio of the WBC and the platelets? So more platelets, less WBC, the ratio more than 90%, that's an A class. And whether you need to activate the platelets or they're activated itself. Essentially, more the amount of platelets, more the dose injected, and better the ratio of platelets versus WBCs, the better the system, is what is traditionally thought. But what we need to see is the clinical effect. So we already know that there's a lot of literature published that proves that the ACP works. There's also a lot of literature published that talks about the ACP having less leukocytes, not zero, no anticoagulant, no external substance inside, and hence no adverse effects or lesser adverse reactions as well. So we know three things in summary for sure. The PRP is superior to the AHA for symptomatic knee pain at 6 and 12 months. And this is a meta-analysis I'm talking about. They found that out of the 12 papers that they were reviewing, 6 actually used ACP. And when they collated those results as well, ACP appears to be definitely better than AHA for both pain at 6 and 12 months. Now, leukocyte poor PRP may have a greater effect not only on pain, but this paper by Brian Cole talks on functional outcome scores as well. And then PRP is superior to other interarticular injections for both pain relief and functional improvement. not only at 3 months, not only at 6 months, but going on up to 12 months. Anything more than that is questionable, and which is why we come to this concept where PRP is only temporarily influencing the joint environment, the milieu, without actually affecting any joint structure or the progression of disease itself. So why does the ACP work if it's not the best PRP? When we have whole blood, we get PRP out of it. And essentially, we need to think of this concept where what matters is platelets and leukocytes. That's it. So what the platelets do is they go on to release these alpha granules, and then they have growth factors, the TGF-beta, the PDGF, VEGF, BFGF. And all of these induce anabolic activity in a case of osteoarthritis inside the joint. So there's all plus, plus, plus. And then what's red is the leukocytes. What it does is releases inflammatory cytokines, the metalloproteinase, the interleukin 1 beta. These are all catabolic, inflammatory, negative, negative, negative. So PRP systems, what they do and what individual ACP does is very nicely shown on this slide. So there's blood that's black. PRP1 in this paper was ACP, and PRP2 was PRP. In this case, it was a biomed product that selectively concentrated the platelets. So when you see this anabolic activity, all the growth factors, conventional PRP systems, in fact, even the Angel system by Arthrex. So Arthrex is the company that has this ACP machine. So they also have these other systems where they concentrate platelets at a much higher level. So what we are talking here is that the ACP is actually giving us maybe just 2 to 4 times increase in the growth factors, whereas the other conventional PRP systems are giving us much greater anabolic activity. But we should look at this right side as well, where when you see the catabolic or the inflammatory markers, well, the conventional PRP systems increase those as well, whereas the ACP does not. So the summary is that if you have whole blood and then you take out the white is the ACP, once you prepare the ACP, the WBC count becomes half of what was actually present. And the platelet count increases by roughly 1.5 to 2 times. Whereas if you use any of these other mechanisms to prepare PRP, yes, the platelet count really increases 4 and 6 fold, and in some cases 10 and 15 folds as well, but they're not able to reduce the leukocyte count, and that increases as well. So in effect, an ACP has a much greater, much better ratio of platelets versus the leukocytes. So the concept is that for osteoarthritic knees, the ideal PRP formulation shouldn't be thinking of, oh, I want the greatest amount of platelets. No, it should be more about promoting anabolism over catabolism. The ratio of platelets versus the WBCs is the most important thing. And I think that decides the functional outcomes, which is why, given a choice, having the Angel system and other PRP systems available for an osteoarthritic knee, for pain and functional score improvement, an ACP is a decent option. All of this keeping in mind that the PRP is a biologically active milieu, and there are so many things that we don't know. Thank you. That's the end of the talk.
Thank you, Dr. Seth. Thanks for an interesting talk. I think coming back to the NCR region once again, for our last talk today is Dr. Shiv Choksi from BLK Hospital. He's going to talk about ACP tendo and tendinopathies, and it's considered to be an advanced treatment option with superior outcomes. So I'll let Dr. Shiv let us know whether it's really a advanced option with superior outcomes or not. Over to you, Dr. Shiv.
Hi, a very good evening, everybody. Thanks for having me here. I hope everybody's keeping safe. Thank you, Dr. Jaggi, for introducing me. I would just share my screen in a minute. Yes. So I'll be speaking on ACP tendo for tendinopathies. That truly is to me and to the future of orthopedics, the next generation in PRP. So our orthobiologics is a very interesting, promising, and a young topic for orthopedics, like many, like all these speakers here tonight, here today. It is the use of biological substances that are derived from substances naturally found in the body, which help the musculoskeletal injuries heal quicker. And they may act by healing, by regeneration, or by modification. So when we talk about healing, they tend to heal the tendons, the ligaments. Regeneration, they could regenerate the articular cartilage, the meniscus, and disease modifying would be mainly in osteoarthritis. So I'll be looking at the healing part in the tendons today. So tendons and the tendinopathies. So tendons, as we all know, are dense connective tissues linking the muscle to the bone, which are mainly hypovascular, and they're subjected to a lot of large mechanical loads, and which causes them frequent injuries affecting the tendon functions. So the tendinopathy per se could range from tendinitis, tendinosis, micro tear, partial tear, or a complete rupture. When we are looking at the healing, we are definitely looking at the earlier stages, that is the tendinitis, tendinosis, and maybe micro tear to some level. As the tear progresses, there is a discontinuation of the collagen fibers that brings about degenerative changes in the tendons that also reduces the collagen content and the changes the collagen type 3 to type 1 ratio, reduces it. So here comes a platelet-rich plasma concept. So platelet-rich plasma has been tried and tested, and now over a decade it's been used. It's being used very effectively worldwide, with about 86,000 patients annually, which are being helped by with the injected with the PRPs. And this figure is, I'm talking about 2016. So I'm sure it is a figure of the from the Western side of the world, which I'm sure is now increasing. As in our day-to-day clinical practice, also in India as well, we have increased the use of PRP to quite a large extent. Platelets, as we all know, is no longer just known to maintain hemostasis. It has a wider role, has been covered in various talks today. I will not go into details, but yes, definitely they are very important when it comes to storage and releasing of the bioactive growth factors. So that is what we are looking at, the bioactive growth factors. So this is the part that we are looking at, the transforming the growth factors that are released by the platelets that help in the healing or the of the tendinopathies. Again, there are various ways that the PRP acts, so growth factors, anabolic activities, the anabolic effects, the anti-inflammatory effect. But what is very important in tendinopathies is the tenosite differentiation, the ability of the PRPs to help in tenosite differentiation. So this was a study which shows whether when the PRP was injected, there was an increased amount of tenosite proliferation after 5 days after the treatment. Coming to the autologous chondrocyte conditioned plasma, as explained in my beautifully by Dr. Shah in the previous lecture. So it is another way of just a variant of PRP, which is again, very importantly, as he explained, it is leukocyte poor platelet rich plasma. And it is obtained by a single spin method which just produces two layered division. There is no buffy coat, as against the twin two layered double spinned platelet which I've derived, which is a quick OPD base as explained earlier. Very importantly, when we use a buffy coat PRP, the neutrophils are higher in number as explained earlier, as compared to the ACP, where we have a rich amount of, definitely there is a richer amount of platelets available in a regular PRP, but here in ACP, there's lesser amount of platelets, but definitely poorer neutrophils and purer leukocyte, which really helps in a lot of conditions, especially tendinopathies. So ACP tendo, what we are looking at is tendinopathy when we are mixing the ACP, the autologous conditioned plasma, with a substance which is Virginex XTR, which is an injectable gel which is compromised of a cross-linked bioengineered recombinant human type 1 collagen. So that is what is used, and that forms like a scaffold when it is mixed with the ACP, and which helps in supporting the cell adhesions, proliferation for the tendon healing. And also when after it is injected, it forms a viscous gel over the area holding the platelets, which are then gradually released. So that is very important because it is a single, it reduces the recurrence or the need for injecting PRP or ACP again and again. It is a single injection method which can be used. The growth factors are released over several weeks. It is much less painful since we are just injecting once, better compliance and much, much enhanced results. So there was a study which showed definitely the effects of multiple treatment on tenocytes. So there was a much, much more better proliferation in tenocytes when the ACP was given three times. But here, when we are doing it with ACP Tendo, you just need to give it once and you expect the same results. There was a study conducted recently which was the first clinical trial as this Virginex STR is comparatively new, brought in by Arthrex in India. So there was a study recently in 2019 which showed exceptionally good results when we compared even the ACP Tendo with regular PRP or ACP. In our clinical practice, these days we've been using it very regularly for all our arthroscopic rotator cuff repair, the meniscal repair, and also the OATS when we do. So they are very promising, other than, of course, the clinical practice where we can use it at other various tendinopathies for the lateral epicondylitis, plantar fascia, patellar tendinitis, etc. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shev. I think it was an extremely good afternoon. And all these six speakers have been exceptionally well-versed, very well given top talks. And I think it would have been really informative for all of us here. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank the speakers, Arthrex, and Ortho TV for bringing us all together on this good platform. And going forward, I think orthobiologics has got a great future. Like I said, we are already down to a third generation now. And as this science gets more and more refined and it gets standardized, I think standardization is what we are missing right now, to be very frank. If you look at the literature as well, the literature shows very clearly that there's a discrepancy in the studies coming through, some showing good results, some showing not that good results. And not that good results is again happening because lack of standardization. I've been using orthobiologics for the last 10 years now. I'm pretty satisfied with my outcomes and the patient satisfaction. So like I said, it's understanding, using it in the right scenario, the right patient selection, that is very important. So going forward, I think we should all interact a lot more in the coming future. And I would once again like to thank everybody for taking time out in this busy schedule of theirs. And in this time of Corona, everybody stays safe. That's the only thing I would say. We don't know when the vaccine is going to come. I hope it comes sooner than later, and we can get rid of these masks around us, and we could have more of these meetings at a personal level rather than a virtual level. That's always much better, to share your thoughts and experiences sitting across the table rather than sitting across computer screens. But still, thanks to everyone for coming and taking out time, and God bless every one of you. Bye from me. Thanks once again.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Zaki. Thanks for all.
Thank you.